water resources. They're saying here that they can either be physical or virtual components of limited availability. And that is why we normally say that resources are scarce. And these resources, an example of a resource is a printer. Sorry, you have a printer that is can be an input or an output. You can have memory, you can have CPU. So those are the resources that we previously mentioned. And if you're told to list the resources, of course, you can be able to give these resources. And we say the resources can either be physical or virtual components. Physical means like a RAM. You can be able to remove the RAM and see it. Input, output device, you can be able to remove them. You can be able to see them. Like the printer is an output. Yeah? So there are many different types of resources, but we are saying here they are scarce. Memory is a scarce resource. It has to be managed properly. That is why even in our topic we have memory management. The CPU, or what you call the processor, is a scarce resource. You have to do process management so that this resource can be managed properly. So a process is a program in execution. And when a program is executed, it must use these resources. Either it will be using CPU, it will be using memory, it will be using input and output device, and even storage is another part of the resource. And I think that one we have already covered in our previous lesson. Now we have various types of backups. Yeah, so we have different types of resources. If you're now, we are saying here that we have different types of backups. If you look at the notes that I sent for memory management, towards the end, there is a place we have discussed about the types of backups. Now, when you look at the various types of backup that we do in our day-to-day life, one of them is what you call full backup. And this means that when you're doing what you call full backup, you're going to back all the files, and at the same time, you're going to mark them as being backed. So you're backing everything. And the entire process will keep on telling you that this one is backed, this one is backed, this one is backed, and so on and so on. Now, incremental backup is just the variance of what was there and what has been added. And also you're saying that only files created or changed since the last full backup will be marked as being backed up. So if there is a file that is already, it existed the way it was yesterday, and it has not had any change, that file will not be backed up. It will be ignored. Because the system checks the differences. Yeah, checks the differences. Even if you edited a full stop, yeah, that file will undergo what you call incremental, it will have an incremental backup, or what we call incremental copies. Now we have what you call differential copies. Only the files created or changed since the last full backup. And will not mark, it will not mark that the files have been backed up, because just an increment. And then we have what you call daily. We are saying that copies only files that have been changed today. So to keep on checking the difference between today and the day that was previously done the backup. So we have those types of full backup. We have incremental backup. Yeah, it's only going to check from the last changes that have been done. If files have not been changed, it ignores that. Now the differential copies does not indicate that a file is being backed up. And again, for the daily, does not indicate or does not mark that the file is being backed up. It's more like saving. Yeah. It's only updating differences. So those are the types of backup. Now, what are the challenges? You may find situations where you're asked, what are the disadvantages of full backup? For example, you decide every day, yes?
What of the mirror backups?
The mirror backup, basically, it does what you call, it's more of an incremental backup, because when you're doing RAID 1, we call it RAID 1, eh? In data management, it's more like incremental, because you're checking the difference between now and what is on the other end. So it keep on checking the differences between the files. So if you increase and update content, it does backup. So we're saying here that if somebody is doing what we call mirroring, it's just an incremental backup. The system keep on checking what has been added and what was there previously. So it keep on making a copy of that particular image. Yeah? So the challenges of full backup, or what other books will call a dump, it will create dump copies, because you're copying everything regardless of whether it was there. The challenge with full backup is it takes a lot of time. And then requires a very big memory, because you may find a situation whereby you're doing a full backup and you're creating different generations. Maybe every Wednesday you do a full backup. So you'll have a full backup for this Wednesday, and another disk will do backup for the next Wednesday. So you can have four disks. Yeah? One doing backup for maybe every 3 days or every 2 days. So you can, it takes time and it requires question number four. Number one is asking features of secondary memory that has changed over years. I would ask a very simple question. What are the features of mobile phone that has changed over years? The answers will still be the same. The physical size, the access speed, the capacity, the compatibility. What are the features that have changed over time with our TVs that we have in our houses? What are the changes that have taken place over time with our laptops? The physical size, the access speed, the capacity, and compatibility has increased significantly. So these are features that cut across both, yeah? So those ones we may not spend a lot of time on that. Now, when you look at the question two, it was asking about the concepts of spatial file managers. Now, when you look at, when you're talking about this, the aspect of spatial file managers, is like the way we open documents, like the document that I'm opening to now, the PowerPoint. If you open a Word document, that is another spatial file. If you open Mozilla, if you open Google Meet, that is a spatial file. Now, what are these concepts of these spatial files? Because you're accessing a file that is maybe in Drive B, a file that is in Drive E, a file that is on your desktop. So these files are in different locations. But when you open them and they come on your screen, they're basically spatial files. So what are the concepts of a spatial file? Number one, a single window represents each open directory. You are actually opening a particular file. A single window represents each open directory. Yes. So we are saying here that the concept of spatial file managers, we're actually talking about the files that have already been opened. As it comes on your screen, that is a spatial file, because it can be in any of the geographical locations. So we see here that one of the concepts is that a single window will represent each open directory. Number two, each window is unambiguously and irrevocably tied to a particular directory. If you open your Word document that is in the desktop, it will remain in the desktop. If that file is in Drive B, it will remain in Drive B. So it's an ambiguous, you cannot change it from where it is, so it is irrevocably tied to that particular folder where it is. Number three is stability. File directories and window go where the user moves them. If you move your document from Drive C to Drive B, it will move. If you move it to whichever location, it is going to move and stay where the user put it. And it will remain with its all the physical characteristics. And finally, the same window can only be viewed in one window at a time. You cannot open this PowerPoint twice. Whatever we do get, that one of them must be rewritten. So you cannot open two files, a single file twice. You will have a problem. So we're saying that this concept of spatial file manager, you can only open a window at a time. So that's the concept. So I hope you're writing. There's a question you can, if there's a comment you can, I'll keep on checking in the comment section, so that if there is a comment we can be able to, so we can continue. So we are talking about the next question, the differences between multi-user and a single user. Multi-user operating system basically is an operating system that is managed, that is able to manage multiple users. And that means Linux. That means the Windows operating system that you're using, they are all multi-user operating systems. So this multi-user operating system, they're able to manage different resources among multiple users. Yeah. If you look at a single user operating system, an example of a single user operating system is the disk operating system. You can only allow one user at a time. It can manage resources and services for only one particular user at a time. Yeah. So an example of a single user operating system that manages just one user is DOS. All the other operating systems that we have today in the market can manage more than one user. And that is why you can do a video, you can do a conference call, because Android is a multi-user operating system. Linux, Google, Windows, iOS, all of them are multi-user operating systems. They can be able to manage the type of users in different domains. Now, when you look at these are placement algorithms, I think we'll be discussing them later, as we'll be talking about the different types of placement algorithms. We have fast in, fast out, the FIFO. We have shortest seek time fast. We have short jobs fast. We have others that we'll be discussing. But here, the question is, what are the disadvantages of fast in, fast out? What are the disadvantages of you going to the bank? You only want to ask a single question, and you have to wait for somebody who requires 20 minutes to discuss these issues of bank reconciliation and so on. Now, the challenges of fast in, fast out, especially when it comes to operating system, is not very efficient, because you're saying, if you have a process that is in front of the queue and requires 10 minutes, all the other processes, even if they require 2 microseconds, they have to wait until the first process completes. So it is not very efficient. Yeah? It's not very efficient. So if you join us, make sure that you manage your, make your microphone in muted form. Yeah? Now, we're saying here that the disadvantages of FIFO is that it is not very efficient. In that, if a process that requires more time is the one that is at the start, all the other processes will have to wait. And that creates what we call convoy effect. Now, some systems need to keep track of each other. Why? Because maybe there is a process that has to finish so that another one somewhere can start. That becomes a problem. Number three is, sometimes it behaves abnormally. This behavior is called the Bella, what we call the Bilady's anomaly. This normally happens where a process can develop problems in the course of execution. And if that error is not resolved, what happens? You may end up having that process keeping others in the waiting longer. So that can be a big problem. Now, we have what you call bad replacement choices. Increases the page fault rate, and so processes down. Yeah? Bad replacement choices. Meaning that if a process is going to get into the system, and there are other portions of that process that maybe need to be loaded, especially when you're dealing with threads, yeah, then you can end up having what you call the page fault, especially in an environment where you can be able to load different parts of a process in many memory differently. So those are some of the challenges of the fast in, fast out. And the most important is to remember the issue of queuing, even in college. You just want to say that you're okay, but you have to wait until somebody who has issues of January to be clear. That's what we call the problem of fast in, fast out. The other question is about the file allocation table. And I think there was that diagram. If you look at your notes, there was a diagram. I think we have that diagram somewhere in our notes. We're talking about the first part, label one, is what you call the master file or the master boot sector. This contains instructions that are necessary for the computer to boot, or what you call the boot information. So the master boot sector contains what you call the boot files, what you call critical system files that are necessary for booting. And that's why when you look at the definition of booting, it's loading of system files into the main memory. So the boot sector contains SM files that are necessary for the computer to start. Now the root directory basically contains folders in the driver or folder. It can contain files. For example, if you have your laptop with drive D. So if you have your laptop having drive D and drive C, it will mean that you have the root directory of C or you have the root directory of D. So we're saying here that the two parts are the what you call the master boot sector. We have the root directory, and we have the various other parts of the file allocation table that we have in our notes. Now, question three, we are talking about, let me put it in the presentation mode. Question three, we are talking about possible conditions that could cause preemptive shedding. Now, it is very important for us to differentiate between preemptive and non-preemptive. As you can see from our presentation here, we are talking about preemptive. Preemptive means that when a process is assigned a particular resource, that resource can be taken away. But when you say non-preemptive scheduling, it means that when a process is assigned a particular resource, that resource cannot be taken away. For example, when you're burning a CPU, you cannot stop that process because that is a non-preemptable process. If you decide to preempt that process, then it means that that CPU or the burning process will not be successful at all. So we're saying here that what are the possible conditions that would necessitate now what you're referring to as preemptive scheduling algorithm, where you can be able to take away a resource from a particular process that is in execution, either memory, either CPU, either input or output device, or whichever resource that particular process is using. Number one is what you call multitasking. If you have to allow multitasking supporting more than one process at the same time, then you must be able to have what we refer to as preemptive scheduling algorithm, so that you can take resource from process A and give it to process B. Number two is what you call allow interrupt. And you said here that an interrupt is an external request that make the CPU suspend the current operation so that it can handle another operation. An interrupt is an external request to the CPU to suspend its current operation and handle another operation. So we're saying here that if you have to allow that kind of suspending of the CPU from what it is doing to something else, then definitely you have to allow preemptive scheduling. If you have to allow what? Interrupt. So we're saying here, allow interrupt, use of interrupt mechanism to suspend the execution of current processes. And we say here that an interrupt is an external request to the CPU to suspend the current operation so that it can be able to handle a different operation or a different process. Now, number three is what you call context switching. Others will say that it is swapping. If you have to remove a process from memory and take it to the secondary storage and bring a process from secondary storage to the main memory so that you can allow multitasking or you can allow preemption, then you must have what you call context switching. Removing one process and bringing another one. That is what we call a condition that has to be there for preemption. And finally, number four is what we call time sharing. For example, if you're doing round robin, you have to make sure that a process gets 2 seconds, another one 2 seconds, another one 2 seconds, and another one 2 seconds. That means for you to allow that, you must preempt. You remove one process, bring another one. Remove one process, bring another one. So we have to allow what you call time sharing. Give processes a time slice, give processes what you call a one time. And it can either be a time slice or what other books call one time. So you're giving each process equal time. So if you say 2 seconds, it will be 2 seconds. If you say 3 seconds, and so on and so on. So you give one process 2 seconds, you remove it, you bring another one. That's what you call preemption. So there are those four conditions that are very, very important. Now, so if you say that a process is non-preemptive, it means that if you're using what you call non-preemptive scheduling algorithm, it will mean that when a process starts running, it must run to completion. If you look at the four state, the two state, the three state, and the five state process diagram, where you have new, ready, running, either exit or block, then in non-preemptive, it means that when a process gets the CPU, it must run to the point where it exits. All the resources must be available for that particular process to run. Now, let's look at the disadvantages of shortest seek time first. This is another algorithm. Now, when you look at FIFO, the one that we just discussed, big one, placement algorithm. So this is another mechanism of shortest seek time first is another placement algorithm. And we're saying here, what are the disadvantages of shortest seek time first? Shortest seek time first. Now here we're saying here that the process that has the shortest time will be the next in the queue. Remember, we have the shortest remaining time first. That's another algorithm. But here we are saying shortest seek time first. So if a process that was at the queue, maybe if you have a process with two, another one with three, another one with four, and you have another process that comes that requires only 0.5, and the one that has one is the one running, it will mean that once this process that has one finishes execution, the one with the shortest will be admitted next. It will not be preempted. The running process will not be removed. But if you're talking about the shortest remaining time first, it will mean that that process will be preempted. But we shall be looking at these others later. Now, we are saying here that what are the disadvantages of shortest seek time? Number one, there is high chances of starvation. Because if you're in a queue and you have and there are other processes that require shorter time coming, then the process with the longer time will have to wait and wait and wait. And that is now what we call starvation. Longer processes will keep on remaining in the waiting queue because shorter processes are coming on board. So every time a short process comes in, it jumps the queue and go where the processes are sorted in ascending order from the smallest to the biggest. So if a shorter one comes, it overtakes the bigger one and so on. So that is what we call starvation. Number two, switching the directories may slow down the process where you have to moving from one job to the other, you end up wasting a lot of time. And then it is not the most optimal one. Because if the process are not aging, there is the concept of aging. So if you came earlier, if a process came earlier and it has been in the queue for long, the more it stays in the queue, the more it ages to accessing the CPU. We shall be discussing that during our lesson. So we have the problem of starvation. So how do you overcome the problem of starvation? You do what you call aging. The longer the process has been in the queue, the more the priority of it running increases. So even if the other small process is coming on board, the aging of that process will have made that process to be of higher priority because it has been waiting for long. So there are also chances of overhead because the CPU will have to keep on reorganizing the jobs in the queue, That process, an overhead is an extra task that will be required for sorting those jobs and reorganizing them again so that you have them in the assembly model. Now, the difference between a RAM and a ROM. ROM is read-only memory. RAM is random access memory, or what others call working memory. So RAM is the working memory. Now, when we talk about the RAM, it's basically a firmware. It stores programs from the manufacturer. So they are stored permanently. That is why it is a firmware. So it stores important, it is permanent information used for storing what you call firmware, or what you call software in a chip. When you talk about the RAM, or what you call the working memory, it basically stores temporary information used for execution of processes. And we have different types of RAM. We have the SDRAM, we have the others. As the ROM, we have ROM, we have erasable programmable memory, and many others up to what you call electrically erasable programmable. And I believe you mentioned them in your earlier classes. Now, we can continue. I think those ones are easy. We have internal DOS commands. Yeah, internal DOS commands. And we have the others that we call external DOS commands. So we have internal DOS commands and we have external. We have external DOS commands like MD, make directory, change directory, CD. We have others. So they're saying here that internal DOS commands are those commands that are basically within the system themselves. Like you go to the DOS command and type date. Yeah? If you just type date, it will come automatically. Yeah? Come automatically. For example, if you go to the root directory, I don't know what's going to happen, but let me just try. But the internal DOS commands are those that are already in the system, in the DOS environment itself. And that means you cannot change anything that is there. Yeah? You cannot change. Let me try something here. Change directory. If I say time, for example, in the root directory and you type the word time, it is going to return the current time. Like now when I've gone to the root directory of C, the system is showing me that it is 18:00. Yeah, it is showing you the seconds up to the point of microseconds. The internal commands. Yeah? I do not have displayed the DOS, but basically, if maybe I could change and share this. Okay, it's time. Yeah? So enter the new time. So I can just, for example, I could escape here. So I come to the current time. You see, I just like to enter the new time. Enter the new day. I don't need to do that. So I can actually come here and do again. You see, this is C user John. Yeah? If I say CD, I take directory backslash, I press enter, it takes me back to the root directory. If I type time, what happens? It is going to display the current time is enter the new time. You can change the time. For now, I don't need to change that. So these are commands that are already in the system. Yeah. So they are called the internal DOS commands. Yeah? Let me share a different window then here. If we can continue with our screen here, we are saying here that we have internal DOS commands. One of them is date, move, go to, time, echo, and so on, erase, and lock. But external DOS commands, the user has to specify what the computer has to do. Yeah? Like MD or what you call make directory. Yes.
Excuse me, sir. I'm not seeing what you are typing on the screen.
I don't know whether you can be able to see. Is it visible? Here. So I just typed time. Even if you type, I have to go back to the root directory. So CD means change directory. And then backslash, it takes you back to the root directory of C. And then I just type the time. Then I enter. The system just says the current time is. I don't know whether you're able to see. The one who asked the question. Will you be able to see now?
Yeah, now it's visible. Okay, so a bit yeah, visible.
Yeah, because it is black, it will not be moved. And then I cannot change the font. So that's basically an internal DOS command that you will always find in the computer. These commands are already there. But the one that we are referring to as external, the user has to communicate with the computer what they basically want to do. Like now here, I was saying, CD, change directory to what? I want to go to the root directory. So I do what? I type CD backslash. It takes me to the root directory. If you want to create a folder, then I'll say maybe a particular folder that I want to go in. Then the system will take me to that particular folder. So it depends on the user, what they want. Let me share the PowerPoint again. So it seems that these commands are many, but if you look at the introduction to computer application, it is a very fast topic that you are supposed to cover. So maybe, I don't know whether you managed to cover that in your CA, But if you look at the syllabus, the first topic that you're supposed to cover under CA1 is those commands. So if you don't cover them, then you may need to go through at a later time. Now we have what you call process scheduling algorithm. Now, if you look at the paper that we are discussing today, this is the third question of the process scheduling algorithm. Now we talked about FIFO. We talked about shortest job. Was it the shortest remaining time? Now, these are the scheduling algorithms that we expected to go through under process management. One of them is FIFO. So the processes that are loaded into the ready queue are the first one to be executed first. That is why it is first in, first out. Now, with the shortest job next, we're saying here that shortest job in the queue is executed next. It is non-preemptive. Very important. Shortest. Now, if you look at the last one, if you look at the last one, let me edit this so that you're able to see the difference. This is non-preemptive. This is non-preemptive. Meaning that the process that is running cannot be terminated. Very important. Now, what is the difference between the shortest job next and the last one, shortest remaining time? One is non-preemptive, the other one is preemptive. So the point number six, shortest remaining time, the processor is allocated to the job closest to completion. So if there was a process that is running and it requires more time than the one that has come, it is removed so that the one that requires shorter time is loaded into the main. Into the main element. So the two must be differentiated properly, because you can find yourself having a big problem, especially when you have to differentiate. So that's why I have to add the two. One is non-preemptive, shortest job next. The job that is shortest, it has to wait for the one that is running to finish. And then it will be the next. But the last one here, the shortest remaining time, yeah? Number six, this one. It is preempted, or meaning that that process is terminated so that the new one can be loaded into the for execution. So that's the difference between the two. This one is preempted, the other one is non-preempted. So priority based, basically we are saying here that each process is assigned what? A priority. Processes with a higher priority will be executed first. Now, multi-level queue. We have two levels. Multi-level queue and multi-level queue with feedback. We need to differentiate between the two. Let me add it here, because we have, we're just discussing here, but we have another one that we call multi-level, we have what we call multi-level queue with feedback. So that's very important. So we're seeing here that multi-level queue with feedback. We have multi-level queue. Multi-level queue, we are saying here that processes are put in queues based on their characteristics. Yeah? It's like saying that all the principals will be in one queue. For example, if I'm using an example of an institution, all the teachers will be in their queue. All the students will be in their queue. All the non-teaching staff will be in their queue. Even if the line for the principals is empty and there is still food, no one can jump to that queue, except if you are a principal. That is an example of what you call multi-level queue. Process maintained for processes with common characteristics, and priorities are assigned to each queue. And processes cannot be switched between those queues. But when it comes to what you call multi-level queue with feedback, processes can be switched between queues. Multi-level. So that if one queue is not busy, then processes can be done what? They can be switched between queues. as much as we are putting them in based on their characteristics. But if there is a queue that is empty, then you can have processes jumping into those queues. Now we have what you call round robin. Now in round robin, this is where processes are given a time slice, or what you call a quantum. Yeah, a quantum. This one, quantum. They are given quantum, or what others will call, or what others will call time slice. A given time slice. Let me put it in the. So we are saying here that each process is given a quantum, or what you call a time slice. And once a process executes to that particular time that has already been assigned to it, it is terminated. Yeah. So we have FIFO. We have shortest job next, we have priority, we have multi-level queue, we have a multi-level queue with feedback, we have round robin, we have shortest remaining time. Those are very, very important for us to remember. And I think my number is here. I lost my connection, so
yes, sir.
There's no one who is. Now let's continue. So we have the various scheduling algorithms, and I'll try to discuss all of them. Now, what are the benefits of dynamic memory? Now, in memory management, we have two memory allocation techniques. We have what we call stack, and we have net memory. Is that processes are assigned to memory on demand. This is what we discussed. Now, what are the benefits of assigning processes memory on demand during execution? Number one, there is minimal signal friendly because we have given memory on demand. Yeah? Number two, cost equal amount of memory. Yeah? And yet some of the processes may not need all that memory. So you end up having a lot of wastage. So with the dynamic memory allocation, it is more cost effective because you're only assigning memory to a process as it needs. Number three is better memory allocation. Only needed memory is utilized. And of course, better performance, because our main objective in memory management is to ensure that there is proper utilization of.
Jam left, but.
No, we continue.
Yes, sir. Let's continue.
Yes, we can continue.
I think there was a disconnection from my Wi-Fi, but I'm not tethering from my phone so that we avoid downtime. Now, if you look at the benefits of dynamic memory, we talked about performance, we talked about the others. Now, let's look at the types of process scheduling. Yeah, we have what we call long term, we have short term, and we have medium term. Now, if you look at the five steps transition diagram, where you have new, you have ready, you have running, you have exit, and you have admit. You have what you call the other part of blocked. That is the five-step transition diagram. Now, when you look at the long term, select memory from long term basically makes decision. Let me just change things here. Decision on which process. Which process to admit. Now, short term, basically select processes from the ready queue. Yeah? Select one process from the ready queue and schedule them for execution. We have medium term, basically swap out processes from main memory. Now, this one, if you look at the five state transition diagram, we're talking about, let me admit those who are in waiting. Okay, we can continue.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Can you share your screen and see what you can see?
Okay, then we can continue. Although there are many others who are yet to come. Now, when talking about types of process scheduling, now when you look at what you call long term, It means that you're making a decision of which process to admit. When you look at the 5-step transition diagram, we have the new to ready. That decision is now what you're calling long term. Makes a decision on which process to admit into the ready queue. Short term, from the ready to running, which process will be selected from the ready queue to go to the CPU for execution. Now, medium term, either a decision, either to take that process to the waiting, or what you call blocked state or waiting state, or even to terminate a particular process. So that's what we call the medium term, swapping out processes from main memory. So I think that's fine. So those are the two types of, the three types of process scheduling. So we can continue with the other, where we're talking about inter-process communication. Now, inter-process communication is that process where processes communicate with each other. Now, we have two mechanisms of allowing processes to communicate with each other. Number one is called message passing. It's more like a mailbox, where if you have a message to send, you put it in a common mailbox, and each one of us can access. So we say here that uses a common mailbox to pass messages between processes. It could also be a shared memory, where we are saying here that use of certain system call. And we say that a system call is a request made to the operating system. It's a request made by a process to the operating system. So we're saying here that it can be a system call to create and gain access to a certain region of memory, a region of memory owned by a process. So these two are mechanisms of exchanging information. But again, it is very important, as you will note, we'll be looking at the various information that is contained in the IPC or in the process communication model. And I think there'll be a question on that as we go through the question. So we're saying here that you can do what you call message passing, or it can be through a shared memory. Now, what are the circumstances under which batch operating system can be used? If you remember in the old days, batch operating system were used where you were accumulating jobs like payroll. You accumulate information about a particular payroll, and then you bring it at the end of the month for running. Now, what are the circumstances that would allow you to do this? Number one is where there is large volumes of job that are accumulated slowly. Yeah, somebody worked today and 200, tomorrow and 50, the other day and 1,000, the other day, you know, like that. So you're accumulating small bits of job on a regular basis. So that can be accumulated over time, and then you come do a summary of the payroll. So we're saying here that it is where you need to process large volumes of job at the same time, but there is little activity on regular basis. So today that job can be there, tomorrow it cannot be there. So you accumulate it over time and then come process it at the same time. Number two is when you don't need, the system does not need what you call the system operator intervention. So when the work does not need intervention from the system operator, you bring it and the system does the rest. Number two, when there is a big difference between the operation speed of the component, from one end to the other, maybe the user and the machine, there's a little difference in terms of speed, so you can use batch processing. So when there's a big difference in operation speed of the components involved. Number three is when nature of work is distributed. You remember at the beginning, we talked about distributed operating system. If you have jobs that have to be accumulated from different geographical locations, then you can do what you call, you can make use of a batch operating system. So those are the four circumstances that could necessitate the use of batch operating system. So when you have to, nature of work is distributed, then you can go for what you call a batch. The other question was talking about the benefits of batch memory. And you said here, batch memory is a situation whereby the operating system utilizes part of the secondary storage to complement the main memory, batch memory. Other books will say, is a situation that creates an illusion that the user has continuous working memory, whereas some work is residing from the secondary storage. So we are trying to use the secondary storage to complement the main memory. So we are saying here that one of the benefits of batch memory is portability. Program work, regardless of how much RAM is available. So even if your RAM is very big or your RAM is very small, you don't mind. The system can also be able to accommodate very big jobs. Yeah, and that's what we call portability. Program one, regardless of how much actual memory is present. Number two is convenience. It conveniences programmers. Yeah, the programmers can work with large sparse data structure with impunity because you don't care how much memory will be needed. It will be provided for in virtual memory. So there is convenience of programmer because they can run and assign different variables as much memory as they want. Number three is efficiency. No need to waste real memory on code or data, which isn't used. So you can actually use what you call the virtual memory. And that becomes a benefit in terms of efficiency, convenience to the programmer, and also the aspect of portability. Now we have advantages of IPC again. You remember we talked about the inter-process communication. What are the benefits of processes communicating, either using a mailbox or a shared memory? Number one is it allows coherent access of information, information sharing. The computation speed is improved, yeah, by various lines, whether it is CPU or IO channels. The computation speed is very high because processes are computing, are communicating with each other. Modularity, divide the system functions into split processes or thread. Now, when you do inter-process communication and you're dealing with modules, a module is a portion of a program. But now when you have a thread is a portion of a program in execution. It is basically a module that is running, that is a thread. So if you have modules and you're doing what you call inter-process communication, when you split your processes or a portion of a process that you call is the thread, then the aspect of modularity is there. So you can be able to enhance modularity. And this helps, especially when you're switching processes and it is a thread. A portion of a process is the one being switched on. It improves it improves our speed. There is also the aspect of convenience. Work on many tasks at the same time. Now, if you have several processes running and you're bringing in modules or you're executing threads, and you say here that a thread is a portion of a process in execution. You don't bring the entire process in memory. You bring a portion, you bring a module of a process for execution, and that becomes a thread. So it's convenient, as you can be able to bring in many processes. And when you're doing inter-process communication, every process is communicating with the other. So you're able to tell process A is using this, process B is using this. And even when you reduce now the processes into threads, it means that the execution speed will become much better, and even communication becomes much better. So those are the four advantages of inter-process communication. And even at home, there are the benefits of communicating. Yeah, you share information. There is convenience. You don't inconvenience people. They are worried that it is capital and they don't know where you are. So the same concept is borrowed. Yeah, people can be able to make decisions. Yeah, computation speed or the speed of making decisions is much better. So we can relate this with what you call interpersonal communication, information sharing. You don't inconvenience other people. And then people can make decisions much faster. If you're in danger, they can be able to help you. But if you don't communicate, then definitely it ends up bringing a lot of inconvenience. Now we have what you call logical security. There is what you call physical security, and we have what you call logical security. Logical security and entails now the software part. Physical security entails what you can be able to see, what you can be able to do. Now, for example, if I talk about physical security, it can be putting up a watchman at the gate, having a burglar-proof door and windows, having cameras, having motion sensors, placing your computers in 10th floor. That is physical security. But when you talk about logical security, you're talking about the use of password, biometric authentication, you can create account, you can do encryption. That's what we refer to as logical security measures. Now, when you look at encryption, we are saying here that you scramble data so that if somebody wants to read that information, will require a key. Yeah, that person will require a key. It's very important for us to note the two differences between logical and physical security. Logical security, you can do encryption. Data may be scrambled. Yes, yes.
Kindly share your screen.
Okay, I'm not sharing it.
No.
Okay, that's one. Let me just check. Okay, I'm not unshared. Can you be able to see this? Are you okay?
No, not yet.
Not yet, let me just try again. Is it okay now?
Yes, it is okay.
Yes, it is okay. It's okay.
Okay, so we're saying here that we have logical security and we have physical security. Physical security entails what you can be able to see and what you can be able to touch. Physical security, an example, can be a burglar proof door, a burglar proof window, placing your computers in 10th floor, that is part of physical security, having a watchman, installing motion sensors, having CCTV cameras, all those are logical security, physical security measures. Now, when it comes to logical security measures, we're talking about the software part. It can be the aspect of encryption. Crumble your data so that not unless somebody has a key, that person cannot be able to read the content. User account, yeah? Like what you do, you can create accounts in your laptop so that you have user A, user B. You can have passwords. Of course, we normally talk about user accounts and passwords.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
You have shared your quick access, not the notes.
Nothing more to read.
It's okay now.
Okay, then we can continue. Now, we're talking about logical security. You can do what you call encryption, user account, password, then biometrics. So those are the basic logical security measures that you can have. Yeah. So biometric, we have what you call even face recognition can be part of it. Yeah. It's part of the biometric part of it. Physiological and behavioral features. Others will use the walking style, the system that are able to detect the walking style and note that this is person. Others can be the iris, it's part of the biometric. This particular eye comes here, open the window, open the door, sorry for that particular person. So we have different mechanisms of implementing this. If I go to the page placement algorithm, page replacement. Now, if you remember when we were discussing about memory management, that memory is divided into things. Or the process is divided into frames, remember? When you're talking about paging, and we are talking about simple paging, and we talked about segmentation, simple paging. The process, the memory is divided into pages. Why? The process is divided into frames. Now, we're talking about page replacement algorithm. How do we change content in memory? You want to bring a program into memory and you're using paging. Now, what are these page replacement algorithms? It can be optimal page. Replace the page which will not be used for the longest period of time. That is optimal page. Pages that will not be used for the longest time. That is where you place your data. It can be not recently used. The algorithm remove a page at random from the lowest numbered non-empty class. That means the page that has not been used most recently is the one that is going to be used to place that. We have what we call the second chance. It works as fast in, fast out. It checks to see if its reference bit is set. It is not set, then you can swap in that particular. In the second chance, you can give it data. If you had previous data, you give it again. That is the second chance. And then you have the opposite of that, least recently used, where you're saying that if a particular page has not been used for the longest period of time, you place data on that. So optimal, the one that has not been used for the longest period of time. Yeah? And then we have least recently used, the page that has not been used for the longest period of time. We have the second chance. Basically, you're using fast in, fast out. You can be checking the frame or the page that have actually been used most recently. It is flagged, and data is placed there. And there are benefits of that, because you can find faults with particular pages of memory. So if you have one that has already been successful, then you can go for the second chance. Then we have what you call not recently used. Again, removes a page at random from the lowest number of non-empty classes. why you have never placed data in the reason you place your metabolites. So those are the paid placement algorithms. And I believe there are even decisions where you say, I'm going to place this here because it has been working better here. Even in the rooms, you can decide that you're going to store items here because we find this better room or a better place. And you can relate to that. So we have definition of terms here. We have what we call static linking. We have dynamic linking and we have static linking. Now, static linking, we are saying here that the program and data will basically be together. So it is we're saying here that it is the result of the linker copying or library routine used in the program into executable file, static linking, where you're bringing the data and the program together and you place them in a particular location. Yeah? Dynamic linking, you can bring in data and programs differently depending on this. We have logical addresses. So logical addresses are addresses generated by the CPU. Even if you stop at that point, addresses generated by the CPU. Now the physical address, they are addresses that are in a chip. They are the physical storage. For example, if you have a memory chip that you can touch, that you can pocket, and you're saying that is the physical address. It is the actual address in a physical chip. But the logical address is basically the address that is generated by the CPU. This is basically what the software thinks. But the physical address is what the hardware knows. I think we have talked about that. Swapping, we are coming into it again. When we were talking about thrashing, we talked about swapping. Now, swapping is a technique of where programs are exchanged. Swapping is the process of exchanging content in memory with content in a secondary storage. Technique that enable computers to execute program and manipulate data larger than the main memory. That is swapping. Or the process of exchanging. Let me just change this language here. Swapping, because we're defining now the process of exchanging. That process of exchanging content of memory with content of secondary storage. Content in secondary storage. That's what we call swapping in a simple language. A lake is basically a storage that holds large vast of raw data in its native form. It's a storage for raw data, large storage. Repository is a storage repository, or basically a storage that holds vast amount of raw data or unprocessed data. That is what we refer to as a data lake. So we have swapping, we have logical addresses. So if, for example, you're told to define logical address, you don't need to go to a lot of storage. You can say it is the address generated by the CPU. Physical address is what the hardware knows, basically, or the addresses that are in a memory chip. If I go to six types of semaphore, the question is, what is a semaphore? What is a semaphore? You can just add it here. And we say here that a semaphore, an integer value used for process synchronization and synchronization. An integer value, semaphore. Semaphore is an integer value used for process synchronization. We want to coordinate processes. So what do you use? You use a semaphore. Now, we have two types of semaphore. One is binary. A binary can be one or zero. Now, we're saying here that a semaphore zero will say wait. And I think I can change this to wait here. This can be wait. And signal means you proceed on zero. Let me maximize this. So we are saying here that we have two types of semaphore. We have the binary and we have the counting semaphore. So they are all used for process synchronization. When you're using a binary semaphore, it takes only two values, a zero and a one. So we're saying here that a binary semaphore will basically contain two values. A zero meaning wait, a one. So we're saying it takes only a zero and a one. Only. So wait operation is when you have a one and signal operation when you have one. That's it. So every time you have a one, you wait. Every time it is a zero, the process signals a particular operation to go. Now the counting semaphore can take either both positive or negative integers. Please note, you're talking about integers, not 1.5. An integer is a whole number, either a one or a negative one, or negative five, or negative three, or two, or three, or four, or so on. So you can assign different resources, different numbers. The CPU can be one, input-output device can be negative one, negative two, negative three, negative four. Memory can be two. Hard disk can be four. So you're saying here that semaphore takes a negative, can take a negative number, meaning one, negative one, negative two, negative. It can take different numbers. So we're saying here that, and you cannot restrict. So we're saying semaphore can take a negative integer value and have unrestricted value domain. They are used to coordinate the resources access where the semaphore count the number of available resources. You can give 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You can have negative 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and this will define different resources. So they can, they're counting. You can say negative one, negative two, negative three, negative four, or it can be 1, 2, 3, 4. So counting has no problem. But the binary semaphore only takes two, 0 and 1. 0 meaning signal, 1 meaning date. So those are the two binary counting semaphores. You see, a semaphore is an integer value used for process synchronization. Very important. The differences between process running and process block. This is in the 5-state transition diagram, 2-state transition diagram, no, 3-state and the 5-state. Running, the process is using the CPU. Block, the process is waiting for an I/O operation. The process is waiting for an I/O event or an I/O operation. We have new, the process has been admitted. Exit, the process has successfully completed execution. So you can have new. You can have ready. Ready means that the process is waiting to be assigned what? The CPU. Running, the process is using the CPU. Blocked, the process is suspended or it is waiting for a particular I/O to happen. So those are the two types of definition there. But you can look at the 5-state transition diagram. It's very important. Now, what are the factors to consider when you're selecting an operating system other than cost? As you can see here, there is no cost. Why did you go for Windows and not Linux? Why go for an iPhone and not an Android phone? Now, one is portability. You're able to move from one platform to another, especially for the computers. Portability, yeah. Portability, scalability, the type of software to run, the number of users, authenticity, the genuineness of the software, scalability, can it be updated? You can add here also application. The application to run, or application to be is very important. We're saying here that when you're choosing an operating system, other than cost, there are many things that you can consider. Yeah, portability, compatibility, scalability, memory capacity. Now, how much memory does it take? Again, compatibility. Point number two, it can be which software, basically, compatibility with the software. I think that is a duplicate on application to be used. Compatibility with the software, compatibility with the hardware. Because if you want to install Windows 10 in your mobile phone, the hardware cannot allow. Scalability, do you want to upgrade it? I think I can change the last one to what you call user-friendliness, yeah? That's why we are all in Windows. It's a friendliness because Linux is stable. Linux is good, but it's not very stable because at times you have to engage different commands. And also, if you get stuck, you can talk about cost. Yeah? Factors to consider, you can talk about cost. Now we have methods of disk allocation. How do you allocate the disk space? It can either be contiguous, meaning you are allocating processes on consecutive memory addresses, either 001, 002, 003. That is an allocation for process A. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0 contiguous or consecutive. Let me use a different word. Consecutive set of each file occupies consecutive contiguous. Each file occupies consecutive memory addresses. Consecutive memory addresses. In memory. That is what you call contiguous. Linked. We are saying that each file is a linked list of disk blocks. Yeah. So we're saying that when I go to block one, it will take me to block two. It will take me to block six of where that I stored. It is going to link me to the next block and the other block and the other block, especially when your work is scattered. So you can use links. Now the index is where you have a single block. You can look at the notes. A single block that will give you direction to all the other locations where your work is. And that is where we're using what? Pointers. We're using pointers here. As you can see, we're using pointers. Let me bold that. We're using pointers. So we are saying here that under the contiguous, we are using consecutive memory addresses. Linked, each file is a linked list. Yeah, so at one entry point, you can be able to go to all the other points because you're using links. Index, you're having a pointer. So you have one block that will give you the memory addresses of all the other information about that particular file. So special disk known as the index block contains the pointer to all the blocks occupied by the file. So it's more like walking into the 10-story building and you have a board telling you that first floor, there is this. Second floor, there is this. Third floor, there is this. From one point, you can be able to know where to go without wasting time. But for the link, you have to move from one point, and then from the next point, you can know the next point, and from that other point, you can know the other point. That's what we call link. So we have those three methods of file allocation technique. Now, causes of thrashing. Is a condition where the CPU waste takes more time. Let me just add this here. And we're saying here that thrashing takes more time. We're saying here that thrashing is a situation where the CPU takes most of the time swapping processes. So when a process comes in, it is swapped, it is taken out. It comes in, it is taken out. It comes in, it is. That is what you call thrashing. Now, what are the causes of this thrashing? One is high degree of multi-programming. When the number of processes keep on increasing in memory than the number of frames allocated to each process. So if you have more processes coming on board and they're not allocated for execution, then you end up adding and removing. Lack of frames. When processes has less number of frames, then less pages of that process will be able to reside in memory. And hence they will be removed. Yeah? So those are the two causes of thrashing, lack of frames, and the high degree of multi-programming. So it will result to CPU bringing in and removing, bringing in and removing, bringing in lack of frames. And the process has less number of frames and less pages. So we talk about frames. A process is divided into frames. The memory is divided into pages. So we're saying when the process has less number of frames, then less pages of that process will be able to reside in memory. That means the process will keep on being moved in. So I don't know whether from your end you are able to get that properly. So we have causes of thrashing, and the same thrashing is a situation where the CPU takes most of the time swapping processes. So one of the causes of thrashing is high degree of multi-programming and lack of frames. Now, we talked about the differences between hardware clock and software clock. I think this is one of the last, it's among the very, very last topics that we discuss in a normal class in the operating system. Now, the hardware clock will basically show local on universal time. Local on universal time. Now, the hardware clock is set from the BIOS, or what you call the basic input. So we are saying here that you will find in the BIOS, the basic input output system, you can set the time. You can set the date, you can set the time mode using that clock. So that can be done at the BIOS point. So it's more of hardware. But when you look at the software part, we're saying that like the time that we show in our screen, it will show the universal time at all times. Higher reliability and make it easier to update. It is easier to update the clock or the software clock that is on your machine. Like the one I was typing time, it is easier to update. Yeah? Sorry, supposed to move to the next. Those are the two types, the differences between the hardware. One is set from the BIOS, the other one is easier to set from your desktop. Advantages of thread. And we say here a thread is a portion of a program in execution. Remember, I defined that previously. So we are saying here that a thread is a portion of a program in execution. Now, I give an example with when you're in the kitchen. Instead of moving with the entire gunia of sugar to the kitchen, you have your sugar dish. You go pick a small portion and you come with it in the kitchen. That is what you're talking about here. One of the benefits of having a thread operating a portion of a program, number one, is it minimizes context switching time. Like swapping, if you have to remove a whole program that is running, or you're removing a portion of a program, it takes shorter time to do what you call context switching. Again, use of thread will provide what you call concurrency. You can be bringing a portion of process A, and at the same time, you're bringing in process B, you're bringing in a portion of process C, and that enhances concurrency. More processes can be executed by unit time. And then there is efficient communication, especially if you're doing what you call inter-process communication, because you're not bringing the entire process, you're taking a small portion, and that increases efficiency. It is more economical to create context switch thread, yeah? Because it is, you're not swapping out or switching the entire process. Again, it allows better utilization of your process. And that's why you can be able to do what? Multiprocessor. So you can be able to have more than one processor, but it is handling so many processes. So thread allow utilization of multiprocessors architecture at a greater scale of efficiency, because you're not bringing on board the entire data. You can be able to handle a lot of work in a multiprocessor. And you say multiprocessor means you have more than one processor. So you're utilizing it much more better. Buffering. A buffer is a temporary storage in input or output device. What are the benefits of buffering in input and output device? What are the benefits of having a temporary storage in your printer? What are the benefits of having a temporary storage in the face recognition device, which is an input device? What are the benefits of having that small temporary storage in the biometric reader? What are the benefits of having storage in your photocopier, a temporary storage in your photocopier machine? Number one, it minimizes what? Data loss. Number two, non-blocking of processes. You can be doing several processes at the same time. For example, if it is a printer, you can have several jobs in the waiting queue, because that temporary storage is holding that work. So once the first person finishes printing, it picks number two, it picks number three, it picks number four. And finally, you're bridging the speed differences between your CPU and that particular device. So those are the benefits of buffering. Yeah. So those are the benefits of buffering. Somebody who wants to just sleep. Just disappeared again. Now, those are the benefits of buffering. The benefits of buffering. The benefits of having a temporary storage in your input device, like a face recognition or biometric, or the benefits of having temporary storage in your printer, in your photocopying machine. The benefits of the distinguish between a memory register and memory chip. Registers are found inside the CPU, so they are smaller. Memory chip is bigger, like your RAM is a memory chip. It has bigger capacity. Your memory chip is an integrated circuit that is made up of capacitors and transistors. So if you accumulate thousands and thousands of capacitors and transistors, you create bigger capacity. And so that's why we're saying it is an integrated circuit. Number two, we are, under the memory registers have smaller capacity. Again, they are very fast. They are very fast. Remember, religious tasks are very fast. One thing we should note that they only contain what? Addresses of memory location. Where data is stored. They contain addresses of that. Where data is stored. Memory chip, they will contain the actual physical addresses. But what is important is that it's an IC, it's an integrated circuit. It's made up of addresses. The other one will contain addresses of memory location. Where data is stored. It's important to differentiate that. All registers are inside the CPU. And we have different types of registers. We have accumulators, we store the results. We have the memory address register. We have many types of registers. I'm thinking of those the other. What are the goals of protecting files? Yeah? Why should we have biometric? Why should you have face recognition for your mobile phone? Why should you have user password? Why do you have to do encryption? Number one is to have well-defined what? Operation. Who is supposed to do what? If it is a student accessing using this password, as long as he's a student, these are what he can be able to, or she can be able to do, to define operation. Number two, protection problem. Ensure that each object is accessed correctly and only by those who are authorized. So it's important to know that. So there are many other goals of protecting files. Of course, you can draw them from the two. Yeah. Prevent unauthorized access, security, you know, all that. So those are the two goals of file protection. You can go to D1. Identify each of the parts, and I think this is what was the question asked? Identify the part. I think it is PCB, yeah, where you have what you call the process state. Number two was register related information, memory related information, and the status information or what we call list of open files. Now, if you look at that question paper, I don't know whether we can be able to access the question paper. Look at one sometimes, but it was asking about the diagram there. And it was the diagram of the PCB, the process control block. You can find one that is having the process ID and process state at the top. So it will depend on how the system is. So you can decide whichever diagram, but there will be similarity in terms of how that information is. So the first part, number one, is the process state. Number three is registered data information. Number four is memory related information, and finally number four, it can either be status information related to IO or what you call the list of open files. It will depend on which diagram, but they are somehow similar. So what are the roles of the PCB? Role of PCB, the process control group. Define the current state of an operation. Is the process running? Which files are open, which memory register is pointing where. So you can have PCB helping you to give the current state of a particular operation, and then the data structure for processing, data structure. Yeah. A summary of information about that particular process will always be there. So it is important, if you look at this paper, it is the person who was setting it concentrated so much on process management. There's a lot of question on the PCB that is under process management. If you look at the question like where is the process state? Question here on the screen. There was a lot of processes like the thread is still about process. Caching is still under process management. Even algorithms that we were discussing. Placement algorithm and a process that's under memory management. Memory management. So I think that marks the end of that paper. And I believe, God willing, we'll be able to go through the other questions so that we are able to cover much more, God willing, in the coming lesson. But I wish you well, and keep on reading. Keep on reading. There's nothing that is impossible. And of course, don't fear the exam. Just read. Because I know the exam may not be as you may think, because the environment that you're doing the exam may not be very favorable. I know that. But don't fear. So we say that semaphores are integer values used for process synchronization. And I think I mentioned it here, a semaphore. Yeah. What is this? A semaphore is an integer value that is used for process synchronization. It can either be binary or it can be counting. So if you want to synchronize processes, either a process A and a process B, you can either go for a binary or you can do what? You can have the counting. The binary will either be under a weight or a signal. Weight is one, signal is zero. So it will depend. I think we mark the end of our lesson today. And God willing, we should be able to meet as per the schedule next week, and hope we can be able to create more time. I don't know how that would be convenient for you.
Hello.
Yes.
Can you share the last slide of your screen, kindly?
The last one?
Yeah.
That one?
No, the next?
That one?
Yeah.
The process steps. Register related information, memory related, and status information.
Okay.
Or it can be list of open files. It can either be status information or list of open files. Either of the two will be correct.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Okay. Any other concern?
Yes, I have a question.
Yes.
Is there a difference between shortest job next and shortest job first?
Yes, there's a difference. That was question what?
Okay. I can ask.
Let me just go to PowerPoint and then we start being able to locate it. Shortest. It was after these. Should they. What was the question? Must have been at the very, very beginning. Let me see whether I will be able to get it. But I said one is preemptive. You talked about what is shortest?
Just shortest job next. Okay, is there any difference?
Yes.
Between shortest job next and shortest job first?
Shortest job first, shortest, yeah. We were talking about what? Shortest job next, and we have shortest. Okay, we have two types. We have shortest job next, and we have shortest remaining time. Shortest job first. It is the same thing for this. Yeah?
Okay.
If you look at this, shortest job next or shortest job first, the same thing. They are all non-preemptive. But the difference is on shortest remaining time. This one is preemptive.
Okay. Maybe.
When it is running, this can be terminated, but it can be shortest job next or shortest job job first. Yeah.
Okay.
Any other query? Any other query? If there's no other query, I wish you well. Please keep on reading. Don't fear the exam. Don't be influenced by other people. You came alone. You have your own life to live. So I wish you well, and may God see you through as you prepare.